The Molester. He told all the kids to call him Frank. He had married into oil money, in this case a stone-deaf woman in the old Memorial District out of Rice University. When she died, Frank moved into a bachelor apartment with a swimming pool not far from the city park where Nick Hauser and I hung out during the summer of 1949. Frank drove a metallic green Chevy convertible with a white top, rolled leather seats, and a polished walnut dashboard. In the late afternoon, he would park it under shade trees and watch the kids playing on the softball diamond or working out on the chained-up sets of iron weights and the heavy bag in the lee of the park house. Sometimes a bag of golf clubs was propped up in the back seat of Frank's car. He was a hard-bodied, athletic man, perhaps 40, his skin sun-browned, his thinning black hair combed straight back on his head. He smoked gold-tipped cigarettes and lit them with a tiny leather-encased lighter. One time he showed the lighter to me and Mary Jo Scarlatti and two other girls. The girls' shorts were rolled up high on their thighs almost to their rumps. When the lighter was passed to me, Frank took it out of my hand and gave it to Mary Jo. "I got that off a Jap colonel at Saipan," he said. "Did you kill him, Frank?" one of the other girls asked. Her mouth turned up at the corner. "Not me, I was in intelligence," he said, and winked behind his sunglasses. Then he took the two other girls for a drive and left Mary Jo and me at the curb. "I'm glad you didn't go with him," I said. Mary Jo had bongos that made my windpipe close up when I looked at them too long. "I think he's nice," she said. The next day, a new director showed up at the park house. Her name was Terry Ann, and she was a magician at ping pong, volleyball, and every kind of handicraft. She had thick chestnut-colored hair and didn't have to wear makeup to be pretty. She wore jeans and tennis shoes to work and smelled like strawberry shampoo when her office heated up in the afternoon. I found every excuse to go into Terry Ann's office. The first time she saw Frank unloading three junior high girls at the curb, she headed straight across the grass for his car. We could see her raise her finger in his face, her back stiff with anger, her mouth moving rapidly. Then she strode back to the park house, glancing back over her shoulder to ensure Frank was gone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.